Hello and welcome to The Vote with me, Frank Leduc, and I'm joined today by councillor Alex Phillips, who's a Green councillor in Regency Ward and speaks on things like children, young people and skills. The brief seems to have an ever longer name.
Yeah.
I wanted to start by asking you about children's centres, because you've been a vocal critic of the changes being planned. And yet, to me, the plans sound fairly similar to the kind of plans the Greens were putting forward about a year ago. What's different?
Well, I think that our plans changed when we listened to people during a consultation process.
Okay.
We then proposed to change to save the service in a rise of in council tax, essentially. So we wanted to protect it. These proposals don't do that at all. They don't seek to protect children's centres, which I think are very short-sighted, as we saw from the consultation that we had earlier last year, I think. I'm really concerned about what this means, not only to the budget in future years and the knock-on effects that will have, but also to children, young people and their families in the city who will potentially no longer be able to access services.
And what sort of, again, please forgive my ignorance, but what sort of services do people deal with at children's centres?
Well, there are lots of different types of services. The two main ones that look like they will be stripped back or, you know, they won't be available at all are something called a triple P course. And something else.
The triple P parenting?
Exactly. And it's an 8-week course, and it's for parents who have children with maybe behavioural problems, they can't sleep at night, those sorts of things that won't be resolved in a one-off course, you know, an evening course or a course in the daytime, but needs several weeks of help and assistance to try and recover from those problems. And they're very effective, those triple P courses. They are expensive, but the Department of Education has done some research into it, and they will save, per family, they'll save £80,000, and for the council that means a saving of £40,000 in the long run.
So how do they save money? So forgive me, but again, please forgive me. So how does that save money in the long
because
term?
Because they're not accessing essentially more expensive services later on because they haven't they haven't been able to deal with some of those perhaps behavioural issues.
So less likely to need a family social worker, that
exactly,
kind of thing.
Exactly, yeah. It also covers, I mean, not triple P, but, you know, children's centres are really good ports of call for, you know, referring families on to other services.
Yeah.
So, for example, domestic violence and those sorts of things. They're not things that just affect deprived areas or deprived families, that they affect everyone. I think that's one of the reasons why it's really important that we have children's centres and that they have universal access. The other service which is at risk is something called Stay and Play. And again, that's universal access, which I think is incredibly important to not stigmatise some of the services that children's centres offer.
Yeah.
It's a great service which allows people from all sorts of social backgrounds to come together and to learn essentially how to play with their children and get the best out of them.
And of course, we've got lots of single parent households, we've got lots of families as well with one child as well, so mm-hmm. It's a good opportunity, like a nursery, so similar to a nursery, or a bit more structured.
I think it's a completely different service to a nursery.
Okay.
Because a nursery would be where you drop your kids off and then you go to work or you have some time to get on with other things in life. This is where you stay with your children a lot of the time. So, for example,
okay,
there are fathers' groups as well, which I think are really important. And fathers will come together with their children and play and make those sorts of relationships.
Okay, interesting. And I mean, with the current proposals, there's one building that's likely to stop being used, the Cornerstone Community Centre mm-hmm. in Palmyra Square, St John's Church. But all the other buildings that are used for children's centres are staying open, aren't they?
Mm,
I mean, this
yeah.
is, in a way, this is just changing the label on the tin, if you like, for some of the places. I think that's how it's been characterised by the administration. Children's centres is a statutory designation. Mm. It's a name that the law gives a place that provides a certain number of services,
yeah.
and actually a lot of these services will still be available in other places, even if they're not called children's centres.
That might be true, but they're stripping back and they're overloading, so there'll be fewer services available.
In some places.
Yeah, and it will mean that quite a lot of families, we're talking about over 800, maybe 1,200 families across the city, will have to travel further to access children's centres. Those centres potentially will not be able to accommodate for everyone. Yeah. People will then not go.
Yeah.
And the stats may decrease over time. And my real worry is that, you know, next year, the year after, in future years, we'll be presented statistics which show that people are no longer attending children's centres.
And therefore we don't need them.
Exactly, that's not the case at all. You know, our children's centres are very effective in the city. They are all good or outstanding. You know, there's something really to be proud of. And, you know, the Conservative Party, when they were administration, it's something that they really supported. It was the Labour government that brought in children's services. And I just think, you know, we really need to be investing in children under two, under five. That's where the money needs to go. And there are countless numbers of reports and studies which back up that claim, that that's where you need to put the emphasis and money, so that, you know, problems can be rectified early on, and people aren't accessing expensive services later on, and also not having to go through the turmoil for much longer.
Yes, I got you. I mean, with the way this is being managed as a process, I mean, is there an element, do you think, actually, that, I don't know if the word front loading is the right word, but is there an element of trying to get the pain out of the way now to, again, actually reduce, in another sense, to reduce that turmoil, so we don't have the same situation in a year's time or 2 years' time or just before an election, if I were being politically cynical, but I'm not, so I won't say that.
Apparently so, that is what's going to happen. So they're front loading these cuts this year, and that there'll be fewer cuts in the years to come. But, you know, there's no 4-year plan here. We can't see exactly what they're planning for the next few years. We can't be guaranteed of anything. And essentially, I think that these cuts need to be these services need to be protected. We cannot afford for the children, for the families, or for the finances in the future to cut these sorts of services.
We could already be seeing in 3 or 4 years' time some of the costs that we would save by what's called early intervention.
Yeah.
Labour would argue, I think, and I heard obviously some of your Green colleagues making the same case when they were in administration and faced with some of these difficult choices, that actually the financial predicament is not of their making, but it's one they've got to manage and be, I think pragmatic is the word some would use, but sometimes they've got to make choices. Politics is about making choices.
But I think with the Labour Party, you know, let me be clear, these are Conservative Party cuts from central government, but the Labour Party, they have made some very poor choices in the recent past, which have made... which have decreased the council tax base, which essentially means they're in a much worse off position now than they would have been.
They didn't back in the big council tax rise in the
referendum. Well, yeah, I mean, not just in the referendum, but in the first year that we were in administration, we proposed, I think it was a 3.4% council tax rise, something like that. At that time, you did not need a referendum, and we would be, as a council, £5 million better off now had they backed our proposal then. But, you know, they didn't want us to succeed in a very difficult budget situation, and they put party politics, I think, before the needs of the city.
I know they're not here to defend themselves. I'm sure they'll take issue with that. But let's move on. I mean, the kind of arguments you've made about children's centres, presumably the same sort of things apply to the youth service, which is also being reviewed at the moment, where changes are being considered. And what sort of age are the people who use the youth service?
They're usually around teenage sort of ages, so 11 plus.
Yeah.
The interventions that take place there really are incredible. You know, a lot of problems that people develop later in life don't always appear when they're younger.
Yes.
But they appear around puberty. And, you know, our youth services have done incredible jobs with many, many young people and families in the city. And what we're talking about here is a 25% cut to this budget, which really is quite big, especially when you think the budget for the youth service is mainly made up of jobs.
Okay.
So this is people going, so there will be fewer people available to support young people in the long run.
I mean, the drive from central government is to try to get, you know, I mean, what David Cameron initially called the big society, to get volunteers, charities, third sector organisations more involved with running things. I mean, isn't this exactly the kind of thing that voluntary groups like the Scouts, the cadets, etc., should be dealing with?
No, I think these are specialised workers. They're youth workers, they have qualifications, they have years of experience. It's not something that anyone could just do. You know, they've worked over a long period of time with a range of young people who may not be as extreme yet as committing suicide, for example. And so there are fewer service options open to them at this point.
Yeah.
And they're really able to work with them. That's an incredibly difficult thing to do. And it's not something that anyone could do.
Okay. I wanted to ask you, we're going to take a break shortly, but so want to think about while the ads are on. But I wanted to ask you about where we might get the money from if we're to keep supporting these services, because that's always the question you're going to be asked again. But we're going to take a quick break. Please join us just after these ads. Don't go away. Welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and Councillor Alex Phillips, a Green Councillor on Brighton and Hove City Council. Alex, we were talking before the break about, you know, if we're not going to... Yeah, the Council's in a really difficult financial position, I think. It has been for the past 4 years when the Greens ran the show. Labour have not got any easier task, really. So if you want to support children's services and youth services and keep the money in those budgets, which you want to do, where do we get that money from?
Well, you know, we're not in administration this time.
Thank goodness.
But, you know, I think Labour being, you know, one of the biggest parties in the country, 112 odd councils up and down the country, is in a really good position to oppose these cuts and say, no, collectively, we're not going to do it. Because, you know, what we've mentioned that in the past and we've always come up against the argument that, you know, that would mean that central government would then send someone down to deal with the budget for us. They're not going to send someone down to over 112 councils up and down the country, and certainly with a leader such as the leader they've got in Corbyn, you know, someone who is clearly very anti-cuts,
yes,
anti-austerity, you'd think that they'd be in a very good position to do that, but that's not what we're seeing here in Brighton and Hove. What we're seeing is, you know, awful Conservative cuts coming from central government and the Labour Party going ahead with those cuts and delivering those cuts, like administrators, not like politicians. So I think politicians are there to provide the strategic direction and to put up a fight to central government. I think that's clearly what the city wants. They want a fight with central government. Yeah, but I think quite a big proportion of the city do not want to see these cuts. You know, their cuts, the cuts that Labour Party are proposing are really unimaginative. They seem to want to appease, you know, as many people as possible. So they're just cutting across the board. And I would like to see them be a lot more imaginative if they are going to deliver cuts, which, of course, we would be opposed to. But I would like, you know, them to look across budgets and not in the silo sort of sense that they're looking at things now.
A bit from here, a bit from there.
That's exactly what they're doing.
I mean, I know, again, the Labour, the Conservatives aren't here to sort of put their point of view, but I know the Conservatives would say with the cuts that are being under discussion, that actually what they're trying to deal with is that the financial situation they inherited on taking office in 2010 within the coalition government, and actually even the Lib Dems, who, you know, one wouldn't have thought of in the past as being a sort of a party well disposed towards, you know, sort of slashing public spending, actually work with them to try to, you know, refinance the country in a way, if I want a better phrase.
Yeah, David Cameron, just last week, I think it was, wrote to his own Tory council in Oxfordshire, complaining about certain cuts. So, I mean, I don't think it really stacks up. You know, when it happens in their backyard, they don't want to see it happen, yet they're the ones that are delivering these cuts and from central government, you know, and someone needs to say no. David Cameron's sort of saying no to himself. But other people really need to stand up to him.
Because he certainly took a lot of flack over that.
He's,
do you think he just... I mean, you know, some people who go into Parliament have been councillors in the previously, and they've got a pretty good on the ground understanding of what's involved. Do you think there's a sort of a cadre of politicians, people like David Cameron, who haven't been councillors, who just actually don't really understand?
I think it's more than that. I think it's not just not being a councillor beforehand. I think obviously that does help if you have been. But I think coming from the sort of privileged background that someone like David Cameron has come from makes it very difficult for him to understand the knock-on effects that, for example, closing children's centres...
But there are council house Tories, surely, I mean, in the government. He could sort of say, you know, hang on a minute. I mean, Eric Pickles used to run a council in Bradford. Yeah. He's certainly not from Eton.
No, he isn't. But, you know, he was one of the worst. So, you know, it doesn't always stack up. But I think certainly for a lot of Conservatives who do come from very privileged, those ones that do, you know, they couldn't even understand what the knock-on implications of these cuts mean. And even councillors, you know, I mean... many of us work full-time. It's very difficult sometimes to speak to council officers about things or to really understand, go and visit the service. Yeah. And, you know, I think that's where local government's kind of got it wrong. I think it needs to be a full-time job where people go and see the services for themselves, speak to members of staff. It's certainly something that I do under my brief. You know, I'd like to see... To know how many councillors in the run-up to the Children and Young People's Committee, how many of them visited children's centres that were under threat, spoke to people who were involved in the youth service, you know, and so on and so forth.
The review of special educational needs, the possibility of merging six schools into three, sort of, which will free up some buildings, which presumably can be sold to generate income for the council, capital.
And will lead to job losses as well.
It will lead to job losses. But, no, I mean, those, by and large, with that review, I take it the job losses are predominantly likely to be at the management, because you'll only need one head teacher, for example.
They're not all at management level. So, for example, there's one pupil referral unit which is set to close, and it has an on-site caretaker.
Okay.
And he will lose his job.
So okay. But in terms of like the frontline care that's being provided, there's and with no disrespect to that caretaker or indeed any of the managers who will lose their jobs if this consultation goes through to a decision and that closes. But you know they're taking out, if you like, what they'll probably say are back office jobs to try to invest as far as possible, given the financial constraints, in the front office, in the frontline services, the people who are looking after our vulnerable children, you know, the children with learning disabilities, people with special needs. Is that not something you can buy into?
I think the problem is there were very mixed messages in the report. Certainly they were talking about, it being led by finances, but they were also saying, on the other hand, it's being led by trying to deliver better services. So there wasn't a very clear strategic overview or a message around that.
But can you not try to do both? I know it's a hard ask.
I don't think finances should come into it, really, especially when we're talking about, you know, disadvantaged young people, and I think it should be led by service users in this case and their families, which this is certainly not being led by them. And I think that essentially at meetings such as a Joint Health and Wellbeing Board and Children and Young People's meeting, you know, really you do need a lot more detail to agree to some sort of consultation like that. And officers were unable, really, for me, to provide the detail that I was requesting.
I mean, the argument they put up was that actually, we before we spend a lot of time and money coming up with really detailed proposals, we want to tell you roughly the sort of direction we're heading in.
But they've done that in the past, and people have been really unhappy and concerned with the outcome of the consultation that was then produced. So I think that they should really learn from the experience gained.
I know it's not my job to defend them. It sometimes seems like they're caught in a rock and a hard place, that if they...
Well, you know, they're told what to do by the administration, aren't they? Yeah. And I think the administration, especially as a minority administration, needs to take a better view on things. And to bring everyone along, they do need to give us more information.
One of the difficulties, though, with this area, with special education, we've got, I think, probably 800 or so children with special educational needs or who are, you know, being helped quite considerably locally. Some of them are, you know, will have T21 Down syndrome. Some will be have other things that make it harder for them to be part of the mainstream day in, day out. These are expensive services on the one level, and yet talking to service users, actually the really hard thing is some of the children find it difficult to communicate, some of the parents don't have time, they're actually, their day is so wrapped up in being woken before I would like to be out of bed, and having disturbed days, having, you know, really not having all the help they would need. The last thing they want is probably to talk to some official about how the service should look in the future, even, no matter how important it is to them.
Yeah, but I mean, there aren't just the families, there are the service users themselves, you know. People who have special educational needs can still have a view on what they would like their service to look like before any consultation is then devised, and that can help feed into that consultation. Certainly the teachers, the members of staff on site, you know, all of those sorts of people, I would have thought, need to be involved in sort of the preparatory work before you then go on to have a consultation.
Okay, before we wrap up, I just want to change the subject slightly, because I know these are issues you're not alone in getting very passionate about. Before the election, your ward was represented by the former council leader, Jason Kitcat, and his wife, Anya. At the election, it's you and your husband, Tom Druitt. I know you're not the only husband and wife team on the council. It's not a prerequisite for representing Regency Ward, is it?
I hope not.
Otherwise, you could be landed with a job forever until another couple comes in. I mean, is it a good or a bad thing having, sort of, you know, I mean, so I have heard it said, for example, when you get a husband and wife team on the council, you actually end up getting one councillor effectively for the cost of two, which is the opposite of a buy one, get one free.
I think it really depends on the two individuals. In the case of Tom and I, we don't agree on everything, you know, and we have
different... Husband and wife not agreeing on everything.
Yeah, we're happy not to agree on everything. And we're very different people, and we you know, we're interested in different issues, which is quite good because it means that we can kind of balance that workload. I think it's really important, actually, in a ward like Regency, not that you have a husband and wife team, but that you're represented by both genders. And that's not the case in all of our wards.
And then you've got a good team as well, I guess. Right. Well, Alex, thanks ever so much for joining us. I do hope you come back another time, and probably on a warmer day as well. Thanks very much for watching, and please come and watch the vote again soon. Goodbye for now.